This is CPX number 31, The Singularity of the Roman Pontiff. We consider the ninth article of the Creed as found in the Catechism of Pope St. Pius X, CPX. This is 9.2, page 28 to 29. Question and answer, number 8 to 12, the Church in particular. God give you his peace. Let's begin in prayer. In nomine Patris et Filii et Spiritus Sancti, Amen. Heavenly King, Consoler, Spirit, Spirit of Truth, who art present everywhere and filling all things, treasure of all good and source of all life, come dwell in us, cleanse us, and save us. You who are all good. Amen. Question number 8. What is the Catholic Church? Answer. The Catholic Church is the union or congregation of all the baptized who, still living on earth, profess the same faith and the same law of Jesus Christ, participate in the same sacraments, and obey their lawful pastors, particularly the Roman Pontiff. Question number 9. State distinctly what is necessary to be a member of the Church. Answer. To be a member of the Church, it is necessary to be baptized, to believe and profess the teaching of Jesus Christ, to participate in the same sacraments, and to acknowledge the Pope and the other lawful pastors of the Church. Question number 10. Who are the lawful pastors of the Church? Answer. The lawful pastors of the Church are the Roman Pontiff, that is, the Pope, who is supreme pastor, and the bishops. Other priests also, and especially parish priests, have a share in the pastoral office subject to the bishop and the Pope. Question number 11. Why do you say that the Roman Pontiff is supreme pastor of the Church? Answer. Because Jesus Christ said to St. Peter, the first Pope, Thou art Peter, and upon this rock I will build my Church, and I will give to thee the keys of the kingdom of heaven, and whatsoever thou shalt bind on earth shall be bound also in heaven, and whatsoever thou shalt loose on earth shall be loosed also in heaven. And again, feed my lambs, feed my sheep. Question number 12. The many societies of persons who are baptized but who do not acknowledge the Roman Pontiff as their head, do not then belong to the Church of Jesus Christ? Answer, no, those who do not acknowledge the Roman Pontiff as their head do not belong to the Church of Jesus Christ. Thus are the words of the Holy Pope. Timestamp? We're just going to look at question number 11 today. Question number 11 was, why do you say that the Roman Pontiff is supreme pastor of the Church? Answer, because Jesus Christ said to St. Peter, the first Pope, Thou art Peter, and upon this rock I will build my Church, and I will give to thee the keys of the kingdom of heaven, and whatsoever thou shalt bind on earth shall be bound also in heaven, and whatsoever thou shalt loose on earth shall be loosed also in heaven, and again, feed my lambs, feed my sheep. Okay, Father David Nix giving you a little bit of my own thoughts here. Notice that Pope St. Pius X uses the singular term here, the Roman Pontiff. There can be only one Roman Pontiff, only one Pope. Most of you know that. But did you know that if we can only have one Pope, that means we can't have two Popes? If you've ever had two men go by the term Pope in history, then one of them is not the Pope. This is not my teaching. It's the teaching of the Catholic Church. Now, granted, there have been times in history when there are two or three men who claim to be Pope, but the Church inevitably judges one of them to be Pope and the other to be an anti-Pope, sometimes too late in her judgment. I believe there have been up to 40 anti-Popes in history. But listen again closely. Any time you have two legitimately ordained cardinals calling themselves Pope, then we know infallibly by Church doctrine that one of them is the Pope and one of them is the anti-Pope. Now, remember earlier today in a question and answer, number 8, Pope St. Pius X made it clear that to be a member of the Catholic Church, you must, quote, obey their lawful pastors, particularly the Roman Pontiff, end quote. To obey the Pope is so important. But Pope St. Pius X would be the first to agree with me in my assertion today that listening to an anti-Pope on matters of salvation may well lead you to hell. Why? Because, again, it is a matter of dogma, de fide, defined faith, that there can be only one Pope. Quick story for you to drive home how obvious it should be to Catholics that we can't have two Popes. Once I was asked to answer questions on the Catholic teaching on salvation at a Baptist college in Florida. And I kind of shocked the professor who invited me by giving all scriptural answers. I think he kind of expected just some kind of pious stories from the Middle Ages. But they were all scriptural answers I gave, and many of the students were interested, many were kind of bored. But one girl said, how can you have two popes? Now, I had just smoked every question. I just knocked every question out of the park up till this point. And then this girl raises her hand and says, how can you have two popes? I said, I don't know. You can't. She totally stumped me. I had no answer after being on fire that whole night at that Baptist college answering scriptural questions. So how did we end up with this error in the minds of modern Catholics? In a book published in 1978, Cardinal Ratzinger had some musings that the papacy could be shared by three men. This was obviously before he became Pope Benedict XVI. Again, he thought the papacy could be bifurcated or trifurcated. Cardinal Ratzinger wrote this in 1978, quote, "According to the triune nature of God, the church must be led by a triumvirate, whose three occupants together are the Pope. It was not lacking in resourceful speculation, which found that in this way, a Roman Catholic and Orthodox and a Christian from the Reformation confessions together could form the Pope Troika." Cardinal Ratzinger, 1978. Yes, unfortunately, the future Pope Benedict XVI once had this rattling around his brain, a certain theological error, yes. And we have to wonder, did it ever leave him? Because he said again, a Catholic, a Protestant, and an Orthodox could form a trifecta of the papacy, which he called a Pope Troika, three religions forming a three-headed monster of the papacy. In German, die Papst Troika bilden konnten. For those of you who are watching on YouTube, I'm showing you the book that Cardinal Ratzinger wrote, where you can find the quote that I just gave you on the trifecta of the papacy. Again, he wrote that in 1978. Actually, that may have been before he was a cardinal. It was certainly before he was Pope Benedict XVI. And you won't be able to see it on the podcast, but just look it up on my YouTube if you doubt that quote. The find on that book, the translation and the picture, are all hat tip to Miss Anne Barnhart, who has done the most tireless research on this topic. So to recap, Cardinal Ratzinger, at least at one point in his life, believed the papacy could be bifurcated or trifurcated. And as much as I don't like to correct a cardinal who became pope, I have to say that is a theological error. You can only have one pope. That is why Pope St. Pius X today in the Catechism calls him the Roman Pontiff, not the Roman Pontiffs. As I said earlier while explaining church history here, any time you have two legitimately ordained cardinals calling themselves pope, then we know infallibly by church doctrine that one of them is the pope and one of them is the anti-pope. This is what the church teaches, and if anyone wants to turn me into the congregation of the doctrine of the faith in Rome for anything I've said in this video, go for it. But you'll have to find evidence of heresy or schism for them to open a case against me, and they won't find it, and you won't find any heresy or schism in this video. Why? Because it's Catholic teaching, and I'm happy to go to the grave defending it. Please say Our Father for me, et benedictio Dei me potentis, patris et filius spiritus sancti, descendit super vos et manit semper. Amen.